Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the dynamic television show Atlanta Live, featured right here on WATC TV Channel 57. We're so excited to have you tonight. I'm Shana Thornton.
And I'm Shawn Evans Mitchell.
And we're your team tonight, bringing you some awesome motivational talk and music. And it's all live here. Now, if you watch WATC TV Channel 57, then you know that the content here aims to educate, inspire, and encourage. And of course, tonight's edition of Atlanta Live will do just that, Shawn.
Absolutely. We have a wonderful lineup this evening.
Yes,
very inspiring.
Oh, yes. We're going to cover the gamut on you. And I can tell you this, no matter what you're going through, tonight you will be inspired, okay? Perhaps you'll identify with some of our guests on the set. Maybe you know someone. Maybe there's something you may be going through in the next 2 weeks. But stay with us because we're aiming to inspire you tonight. Now, you're watching Atlanta Live, and I'm so excited because we're going to go right to our first guest tonight. She's a very special lady with something very special on her heart to share with you and the world. I'm talking about Shawn, the one and only Stacy Robinson. Stacy, welcome to Atlanta Live.
Thank you, Shana. Thank you, Shawn. And Shana, I wondered if you were going to give one of your famous introductions. You always say the one and only. I love it. I love it.
I have to say the one and only Stacy Robinson.
You make your guests feel special. I appreciate
it. You are special. And you're very special because I love your platform,
right?
And you're here to talk about tonight something that a lot of people don't hear a lot about, Shawn. Talking about a speaker's bureau, which may not be necessarily exceptional, saying, well, that's not new, Shana, but it's a Christian speaker's bureau. And I tell you, Ms. Robinson, I'm fascinated by it. Tell us more.
Well, sure. It's kind of a behind the scenes thing. You know, the speakers that we represent are the ones that are seen in public,
okay,
and they're on the platform speaking. But I'm just a little piece of the puzzle, and people that do what I do in helping event planners, mm-hmm, to find the right speakers for their events.
Wow.
And a lot of event planners have used the old boys network,
okay,
the old girls network, mm-hmm, for so many years, and just, you know, used friends of friends.
Okay.
And so their circle of people that they've used for speaking at their banquets, their revivals,
yeah,
their sermons, their corporate events may be dwindling.
Okay.
And so there is another resource for them, speakers, bureaus that are all over the country, and
wow,
some others like mine that focus on Christian speakers,
mm-hmm,
that speak not only in churches and ministry events, but also in corporate conferences.
That's pretty amazing. And
yeah,
you know, Ms. Robinson, when people think of booking a speaker,
mm-hmm,
or speaking to someone to come to an event, right, you often say what you want to happen. What do you want to achieve?
Mm-hmm.
Now, with you managing and coordinating so many different Christian speakers,
mm-hmm,
with this bureau, what's your ultimate goal in mind?
Mm-hmm. Well, my goal is always to help the event. I consider the speaker and the event planner both
okay,
my clients.
I see.
Okay?
Yes.
And so my goal is to help the event planner find the right person for their event. And I always say God is the booker, not me, whether
beautiful,
it's a corporate event or a ministry event.
Yes.
I'm not the person that's going to try to convince you to choose a particular speaker because
okay,
that speaker hasn't spoken in a while.
I
and
see.
We just
okay,
want to get them busy.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the way I operate at all. I really get inside the head of the event planner and find out, even if their question to me is a real bottom line question, I want to find out as much as I can about their event.
Smart.
And their goals and their vision for that event. I ask them about the history of their event. What
mm,
speakers have they had before?
Smart.
You know, how many normally attend their event? And tell me, you know, the other things that happen during the event, whether it's a banquet or a Saturday conference or whatever.
Okay.
And so I get the big picture of what the event looks like and who the audience is, what they want that audience to walk away with.
Okay.
If they have a specific message in mind, sometimes they just want them to walk away with inspiration in general,
okay,
or motivation. If that's what they're looking for, I can usually give them about 50 options.
Okay.
But sometimes they want something very specific.
Okay.
And so for all the speakers that I represent, you know, of course, I have a database of all their details,
mm,
and that includes the different speaking topics that they do.
Wow.
And that's what I was going to ask. It's almost like being in an ice cream shop and you have 50 flavors. You have all of these wonderful, fantastic speakers. Yeah. You've met with the event planner, if you will. They've given you an idea as to what they want. Now you've got to decide who to match them up with. So how does that work?
Right. Well, you know, it would be easy if every event planner that called or emailed me said, I want this speaker. They knew who they want because they can go to my website and see who I represent. But I think they often tell me they're kind of overwhelmed by the options on the website, and I'm sure true at other agencies too. And so they really ask me to guide them to the right person for them. And so I do ask them, you know, is there a specific topic that you have in mind? Is there a specific person that you have in mind?
Okay.
Someone you've seen, you know, that you've read their book, you've seen them on TV, you've seen them in a movie or what have you. And so I really, you know, have a back and forth conversation with that event planner to try to help suggest people that are going to fit what they're looking for. And of course, very importantly, speakers that are available on their date and that work within their budget and that have their topic. Usually when, probably I'd say 90%+ of the time when an event planner contacts me, they're not asking for a specific speaker, they're asking for suggestions. And so what I do is, I don't even name names at that point.
Okay.
I just get the basic, a lot of information, but some of the basic information I'm looking for is, of course, their location, the purpose, the date, their budget for the speaker's honorarium.
Okay.
And then any specifics about the type of presentations that they want from that speaker. And then I say, why don't we touch base again tomorrow? I'm going to contact speakers that I think might be a good fit for you, but let me make sure they're available before I get your hopes up and we even talk about someone specific.
Ms. Robinson, what I love is you've made a science of this. You really have, which is very smart. Now, what spun all of this? What motivated Ms. Stacy Robinson to start a Christian speaking bureau?
Okay, that's a good question. 2002 is when I started.
Okay.
And before I had this agency, I was helping with one of the large churches that everybody would know its name in Atlanta with women's ministry. I was one of the people on the team. And so, you know, we did events. And then a different church after that in Atlanta was also a large church. And I was the person that was responsible for all the women's events in that church. And at the same time, Gwinnett Metro Baptist Association, which is the largest Baptist association of churches in Georgia, I was working with them and some other women on a 4,000 seat women's conference.
Wow.
So prior to even thinking about the agency, I was booking speakers and I was doing a little bit of speaking myself.
I see.
But wasn't full-time speaker at all, but you know, had dabbled. And so I had gone through the process of booking speakers. And this was pre-Google. This was 2000. This was prior to 2002.
So there was some work put in.
Oh, absolutely.
This was
absolutely.
Pre-YouTube, pre-Google, a lot of people even using email back then. This was 20+ years ago. And so everything's changed now. But that's how it started, because I was doing networking meetings for all these people that were also in leadership in churches. And they came from all over Georgia, particularly women's ministry leaders. And I would have a speaker at the networking meeting, somebody local, and we would, you know, have a program. And I would always hear them asking each other, where'd you find your last good speaker? And I would hear some horror stories too, because back then you didn't even know how to vet a speaker, you know, pre-internet. So I thought, wouldn't it be nice if there was someone we could trust to recommend speakers?
That's a good point.
And that was a moment where I knew I was going to be at home without kids for the first time in my life. They were both going to be in school. That was the year I knew I was going to start a business from home. And so God sent me someone that said to me, would you help me book speaking engagements? And I said, well, I'll try.
Okay.
And then other people started coming to me, and I realized very quickly that that was the business that
business
I would start.
Wow. So. And I know, Ms. Robinson, it's a business for you, but it's also a passion.
Absolutely.
And you
it's a
see it as
too.
A ministry,
yes.
right? If you're saying spreading the gospel of Christ, explain.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I'm just a small piece of the puzzle. And so I represent, I don't know what the number is, but currently maybe around 100 speakers.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're all over the country. I'm not just local. And so I'm just a small behind the scenes piece of the puzzle that helps that person that does have a God call on their life to share that message, whether it's a message for corporate or faith audiences. And that's my ministry, is helping match those event planners with the speaker that's going to help that event planner meet their goals and give that speaker an opportunity to share the message they're called to speak.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And that message can be their journey, their testimony.
Yeah, yeah.
And who knows, whoever's watching and witnessing it, your lives can be inspired and changed from it.
Right. I have speakers that do training for church staffs. I have speakers and artists that train worship teams, some of the best vocal coaches in the world that I represent that do these kinds of things. And then just speakers on every kind of topic you can imagine for corporate as well as churches and ministries.
Now we're moving into the summer months, and we mentioned the church ministry. Mm-hmm. There are reunions. Is there a particular time of the year where it's more busy than others?
Yes, there are seasons for speaking.
Seasons, yes.
Yeah. Seasons for everything.
Yes. That's right. The busy season for speakers going to speak is February, March, April.
Okay.
And maybe early May. And then the other busy season for speakers going to speak is after school starts, maybe late August through early November.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Why is that? What have you noticed a pattern? What's going on?
I think it's kind of whether you're a person that has kids in school or not, things kind of revolve around school schedules.
Right. Of course.
And then, you know, so the summer months, they're not doing as many events because people are traveling. After Thanksgiving through New Year's, people are busy with all their Christmas stuff at churches and work.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, it's kind of things that are happening between those periods.
Wow. Yeah. You know, as we begin to wrap up, we have to ask this. Do you still speak? I know you're managing and coordinating over 100 speakers, but you yourself, are you still at the platform?
No, I really don't. But I'd love to share something that I'm doing that I'm not speaking, but I am hosting events in Atlanta called the Atlanta Lunch Club.
Oh,
and
neat.
We're having one coming up soon, so people can go to therobinsonagency.com to get specific information about that. And what I'm going to do is be having at least one of my speakers to actually do a little TED-type talk. A very brief, condensed version of their primary message, so that event planners can come and get a taste of them, and recording artists, and then other speakers that I represent will be there as well for event planners to meet.
So
therobinsonagency.com has all the information about the upcoming events.
I love that. I know many of our viewers are taking that down, Ms. Robinson.
Good. The Atlanta Lunch Club. Everybody's invited.
We're going to have you back on to continue to share all that you're doing.
Thank you.
Congratulations on your success.
Thank
you
so much.
Continue all that great work.
Thank you both.
And what a pleasure to speak with you tonight on Atlanta Live. Wow. Well, you can see we're off to a great start, and we have more amazing guests for you with inspiring stories and platforms. And right now we're going to go to the music set, and we're going to hear from the one and only Brian Courtney Wilson, and the name of this is You Make Me Rich.
Mm-hmm. You make me rich when I receive your grace. Exceedingly, abundantly, above all I could ask or think, you meet my need. My storehouse grows. I have so much I could never give it all away. I am living in the overflow, 'cause you make me rich. Same. Where I am boldly destiny and casting aside my chains because you assume the debt I owed. Paid it all to make me whole, God.
I have so much.
I could never give it all away. And my cup runs over, my cup runs over, over and over. I receive every blessing you have for me. From my good friend who sits high and pours out blessings that the world can give and the world can't take away. You make me rich. Oh, you make me rich. Oh, God, you're the lifter of my head, helping me see. Now I can receive more joy, more peace, grace and unmerited favor. I have so much, I can never give it all away. I am living in the overflow. One more time. I have so much, I could never give it all away. I am living in the overflow. I have so much, I could never give it all away. I am living in the overflow.
And alive. That was an amazing, amazing guest we had to open us up. And now we're about to bring to you very, very informative, knowledgeable information that you can use.
That's right. And we're so excited to have two guests. One is a familiar friend of Atlanta Live. It's the one and only Perry Whaley. Welcome back. Yeah. Whaley is alive. Excited to have you on.
Yes, thank
and
you.
Also, he's joined by a friend and also a medical expert, Dr. Timothy Cowthorn. Welcome to Atlanta Live.
Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Very excited to have both gentlemen on. Now, Perry, do the honor since you are back on with us again. Tell us about something that's very special on your heart tonight.
Well, I just want to say the Vitiligo Man of Action organization is growing.
Wow. Congrats.
We just completed a 5K run. In March, we did a first Vitiligo Man of Action March Madness Awareness Festival. We've partnered up with Atlanta Community School Systems, Salem Middle School.
Wow.
Everything, man. We're just doing a whole lot in the community.
Mm. So you've been very busy.
Very busy.
And so now I'm to assume that this new collaboration and partnership with one of the most popular OBGYNs, I mean, that's something that's kind of grown lately, right?
Yes, yes. I'm going to let him just say this is, I mean, the doctor, man, we met briefly, and now our relationship has grown and has grown, and he's been a part of everything. His team came out and supported it. They supported
it.
Yeah. And now he says he's destined to make this thing happen. So I'm happy to have him with me.
I love that. Now, Dr. Cowthorn, destined to make this thing happen. Those are big words, big shoes to fill.
Yes.
Welcome to Atlanta Live. Excited to have
you
on.
Thank you.
Tell us about your platform or your mission to collaborate with Perry's organization.
Well, my mission is just to bring awareness to vitiligo. Mm-hmm. I recently was diagnosed, or it came on later in life, unlike Perry's. I was 42 when I saw a spot right before my birthday. And so being in the medical field, medical student and all that, I knew exactly what it was.
Okay.
So now being with Perry and connecting with him, it's almost like therapy for me as well. So
this is
a great opportunity for me just to not only spread awareness, but actually get help.
I love that. Mm-hmm. Now, being a medical doctor, explain to those that are listening in right now exactly what vitiligo is.
Okay, vitiligo is just your own immune system attacking the pigment cells, the cells that make pigment in your skin. So when it does that, depending on your skin color, since I am more of a darker skin, you can tell quickly compared to a Caucasian person.
I see.
Which it can happen in
any
ethnic group, yes.
You know, when we discuss medical conditions, often sometimes medical physicians such as yourself, so there are groups more prone to get a certain medical condition. Is that true for this skin condition?
Not necessarily. I just think you could see it in us.
I see.
More
individuals of color a little more.
Yes.
In terms of age, I know you got it as a young man at 42. I know Perry shared with me before his happened earlier when he was in his 20s, if I'm correct.
Yes.
does it happen more when people are younger, middle age, or when they're middle age, or more of 60s or 70s?
I'm not. It happens all across the spectrum.
I see. Yes. So it's about equal.
Yes. So, like I said, I was older, and so some of those things that I didn't experience that Perry may have experienced, or younger folks. So, you know, I was well and happy with myself.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And now that presented itself, I use it as another platform,
mm-hmm.
you know, to reach others even more so.
Absolutely.
And Perry, we were talking one day, and he said, man, I deliver babies on a regular basis, but now these hands can deliver more because you can see
wow.
it on my hands.
Oh, absolutely. So, now, in terms of different ages, support groups, do you find a need to have support groups for different age categories or just one big happy family of sorts?
Well, one big happy family,
sure,
but they do
sure.
have support groups for children.
Okay.
And it's all across the country. I mean, we get response from all across the country. And in June is the official month for vitiligo. And color purple is, let me just show my shirt.
Gotta show this shirt right here.
Vitiligo, man.
Wow.
Of action. But
awesome.
The month of June is when we celebrate it, color purple. All around the country, people just kind of come together because when I first acquired vitiligo, there were no support groups.
I see.
And now, all across the globe, they got an event in Boston at UMass next weekend. I'll be there, and it's going to be a fantastic opportunity to see people that you see on Instagram, Facebook, who are doing your same journey,
yeah.
and now
Beautiful.
It comes together. Everybody comes together.
Mm-hmm. Now, our first guest represents a speakers bureau. Do you find oftentimes that you two are called to speak, either through a bureau or just through personal connections?
Well, it has, since the last time I was on the show, mm-hmm. it's really changed because people, they request now because I speak to a lot of children and teenagers. So now I got 56 schools in the
wow.
community schools. It's Community Schools of Atlanta, and they work hand in hand with me, and they keep me in front of the schools, the
Love
children,
that.
Because bullying, low self-esteem, mm-hmm. all these things are already associated with a lot of different people,
okay.
and they don't even know they're going through it. So when we speak about it and they see us, they be like, if they could do this, I know I could come out and say and do
Beautiful.
What I want to do. So
Beautiful.
It's very inspiring at this time to go out and kids, when they give you the honest opinion. Some say they will put a bag over their head. Some say, I wouldn't want to have this. But at the end of the day, they understand the journey. I went to the movies with a group of children, and I forgot the name of the movies, where the young kid had the helmet on his head. If I wasn't here, I would remember.
It's on the tip of my tongue.
But he was different, and I went there. I spoke to them the week before, and then after that, I went to the movies with them, and they saw where he was being bullied, and they didn't want to be bullies anymore. So this was inspiring because his different look changed their whole lives because they could sit and kind of say, I want him as my friend, and you're not my friend because you're a bully. You know what I'm saying?
I see. Mm-hmm. Wow. I mean, there's so much to talk about, to discuss, and be motivated and inspired by. What do the both of you want to achieve through this platform?
I just want to bring more awareness. And, you know, this, for me, since it affected me at an older age,
okay.
you know, I see patients all the time. And so, you know, I've been in practice for, 14 years.
Okay.
And so patients that have been with me along the way
okay.
over these last few years, now they see me, they're kind of shocked. I can see it in their eyes. So,
okay.
But I use that as a platform to say, hey, it's okay.
That's
Your
fine.
Doctor is here. I'm still the same same physician that you have entrusted in me, and just to bring awareness. And by having Perry here next to me, I didn't realize how many kids I can impact.
Mm-hmm.
And just
Powerful.
Say, hey, it's okay.
That's right.
It is definitely okay. And that has touched me more than anything.
You know, I think awareness is key in education with anything you discuss, not medical, but non-medical as well. Dr. Cowthorn, tell us the education about vitiligo. How important is it for those children and also for grown-ups like ourselves in a support group or those who are just married to individual cousins
sure.
or brothers?
Sure.
How critical is it for us to be educated on it and making sure we're saying things that are true and not believing or uplifting urban myths of
sure,
things
sure,
being
sure.
contagious,
sure.
Mm-hmm. you know, things
right.
of that sort?
So as a physician in OBGYN, I deal with that every day.
Okay.
I'm from Louisiana. parents or my family is in the church and all that come from a preaching family. Mm-hmm. And it's funny how I said, I don't want to do that, you know, or didn't want to go that route. And I'm actually doing it every day.
Okay.
So it is definitely education is the key.
Yes.
It's the key. So I am teaching people. And it's okay. It is okay. It's not
Absolutely.
Going to put you in the grave, but we need to understand
Powerful.
That it doesn't hurt. I mean, I'm not burned.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it is truly just a loss of pigment in the skin.
Mm-hmm.
And that is all.
Yes.
And so just making people aware and the young kids that are affected. When Perry told me that so many kids are abused and neglected or killing themselves, suicide,
yes.
That shouldn't happen.
No,
it should not happen.
Never
because
should
of
happen.
The way your skin is presented.
Absolutely.
You know, one thing that's really, really important that people don't talk about is the family members.
Okay.
You know, no one's talking about that. Vitiligo is so new that people don't know how the family affects, because your mother and your father can say, what was wrong with me?
Mm.
And now they suffer watching their child go through all this, and they can't do anything about this. When you receive this disorder, your life is changed forever.
Okay.
So if it's changed forever, my job, his job, the responsibility of the community is to empower people, and that's what this does. 1% of all Americans
yes.
will acquire this disorder. No discrimination of nationality.
Right. Okay.
Right, right. And guess what? At every meeting I go to, why wouldn't I share it when I'm always the 1%? Today you see 2%,
okay.
but we're normally 1%. And it's just incredible because everywhere I go, people want to know who you are.
Yes.
So we tell them, we're the Vitiligo Man of Action.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
With your platform, what are some of the key talking points that you discuss in terms of education and how to change one's perception? And specifically, let's talk about media and image, especially when we talk about social media mm-hmm. with
Powerful.
Our young folks. Everything is about image. Everything is about a superficial sense of beauty. Do you have a particular, for lack of a better word, recommendation for individuals to be more accepting? How do they accept themselves?
In order to accept yourself,
mm-hmm.
you have to be visible. When you're visible and you're confident, you know what the first thing somebody say? I don't even see that. You know, they say that, but for me personally, yes, you do. You see that. But they see so much confidence and they say, wow, I like that. They see the energy. And when you see somebody that has vitiligo and they're really traveling at a rapid pace,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of beautiful. Like I tell people, when you're doing good things, it's good. When you're doing bad, it's bad.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Because you can't hide yourself. If you do a crime, you can't hide yourself.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do good things, people can say that you encourage them, because sometimes just because you look beautiful on the outside.
Yes.
No, people, you know, it's real deep. It's real deep. It's real deep. So that's what I see. Being visible is what makes it happen.
Wow. I mean, and so when you're saying visible, you're saying be
confident
in who you are,
confident
right?
You are. Yeah, he's a doctor. So if he's walking around with his head down like this, somebody's going to attack him. They're going to be like, oh, look at that man. You know what I'm saying? And that's not what we want him to hold his head up.
Absolutely.
And people say, I want that man to wait on me. Because when I go to places, I'm a car salesman.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
I don't even have to have a business card in the car business, because there's no one like me.
Right.
You know, 1% of all Americans.
Right.
Yes.
I just say lead by example.
Okay.
So sometimes, young lady who stopped me and said, hey, what, you don't wear makeup? I was in action. She said she just saw something that she hadn't seen before.
Okay.
And I didn't realize that, you know, I was performing for her. But what I'm saying is lead by example. I don't see it.
That's right.
When I look out and touch someone, I see it, but it doesn't bother me because I love who I am.
Mm-hmm. And I think
that's where we have to start. You have to love yourself first.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to say that message of loving who you are is important for everyone, no matter what medical condition, if they don't have a medical condition right now. Isn't that important when we see a lot going on in the world?
Yes.
Some of the things we've seen in the news lately of individuals not being happy with themselves, their current life situation, that we have to embrace who we are.
Yes.
And if there's some emotional, internal things going on, that we find the power within ourselves and with God to make that change, right?
Definitely.
Now, this is what I always say to people. I'm going to look in the camera this time, because this is what I want you to know about vitiligo.
Okay.
If you had this disorder, what would you do? Simple as that.
There's a camera right there.
Oh, that's the camera right there?
Go ahead.
Well, all I want to say to you out there, if you woke up tomorrow morning and you had vitiligo, what would you do? Would you cry? Would you make a movement? Would you change people's lives or what? So once again, what I want to leave you with is, if this happened to you, what would you do?
Wow. I mean, those are powerful words and questions to think about.
Because, absolutely.
I mean, anyone's life at any point can change, of course, with any medical condition, or not only medical condition, but there are a lot of emotional conditions that people can go through as well, and mental. And for them to stay steadfast, Perry, how important has your faith been in this journey of life, not just with vitiligo, but journey of life as an individual, as a man?
If it wasn't for my faith at this point, I don't think I would be doing this, for one. And it had, when at my lowest points, it brought me up. And for me to do this, it's not me. I didn't just jump up and say, hey, I'm gonna do this, because I had lost confidence.
Okay.
And God said, no, you always wanted a platform. I got something for you. Mm. And when he gave his platform, he makes things happen. Last year, we were doing a 30-city tour. This year, we're just doing everything. And, he said, Perry, you gotta take lead now. You gotta take lead. So now the vitiligo men, I was gonna name it Vitiligo Men of Action, but everybody can't be a part of that, but because they can't find time. So
I
said, since I'm pushing around here, running around, I said, Vitiligo Man of Action. And people all around, dealerships, schools, and everybody have been embracing sponsorships.
Wow. Yeah. And that's
fine. We may have to change that to men, because I definitely want to help carry the torch, too.
That's important. Yeah. I mean, I think that's something we have to certainly say. How important has your faith been, Dr. Cowthorn? I know you said you grew up in a preaching family, right? Sometimes when we're around it a lot, we're saying, that's not who I am. I'm going to go my own path. You are a medical physician, but how important has your faith been?
All my life, that's all I leaned on. I mean, at my lowest point, that's who I can call on. Mm. And so with this, actually, to me, I look at it as a gift, because I'm already or was involved in my community as a physician and has, you know, from my standards, coming from Shreveport, Louisiana, and in a two-bedroom apartment to now, you know, being chief of staff at the hospital, being a part of my organization, Greystone OBGYN, and now a Vitiligo Man of Action. That's all I can call on. He's always there for me. And so, you know, this actually has been a healing point, because nobody really knows who you're going going through this except him and I, because he can tell, I can see it.
That's
and
right.
One question he asked me a little while ago, we were just talking, he said, Tim, how do you really feel? You know, he said, how do you really feel? I know it hurts. I said, how do you really feel? And I had to shed a tear. Because he actually knows, and actually God has sent him to me.
Yes, he has.
It's a brotherhood. You two have such an incredible chemistry. It's almost as if you've known one another for such a long time. That's really important.
But God allowed this partnership, and God will allow other partnerships to grow with your platform as well. Before we go, tell us, how can our viewers learn more about your organization? How can they get involved? And is it open to all community members? Mm.
Yes, all community members. You can go to vitiligomanofaction.vpweb.com.
Okay.
Or you can go to Facebook, Perry Whaley on Facebook. You can go to Perry Whaley 50 on Instagram, and or you can call me.
Okay.
I always tell you to call me, 678-755-3525. My number's all over social media, so you can call me.
A bold man to put his phone number out on social media. Now, Dr. Cowthorn, something tells me that you're not going to put your phone number out on social media, being a doctor.
No.
But any final words for us as we wrap up?
No, I just appreciate the opportunity to be here. And once again, through the Vitiligo Man of Action, we're here to support and bring awareness to this, and we're going to be having more and more opportunities in the community to share our journey.
Wow, and what a powerful journey that has been really blessed by God. Thank you both, gentlemen, for being with us on Atlanta Live. Awesome
stuff. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Very, very awesome. Well, stay with us if you were inspired by that conversation, and I know you were. But right now, we're headed straight to the music set, and we're back with Brian Courtney Wilson. And the name of this one is My Father Is Kind. Thank you. Amazing voice and what an amazing message. Now, if you've been watching us throughout the night here on Atlanta Live, then you know we've had some awesome conversation that has inspired and encouraged us, okay? And I know you'll continue to be inspired as well now. But you've got to stay with us because more is coming and also more live music. I want you to know that our prayer lines are open. And you're going to find the telephone number there at the bottom of the screen. No matter what you're going through, our prayer warriors want to hear from you. Maybe you got a medical diagnosis that has you a little bit on the edge. Maybe your relationship right now with the spouse or your boyfriend or girlfriend isn't going that great. Maybe your boss is really being unfair to you at work. Do not give up, okay? The end is not in sight, no matter what you think you know, okay? God is there for you, and never, ever, ever let go of Him and His promise to you. He loves you. He's never given up on any of us. And you are no exception. That prayer line is open right now. Again, if you just want to call and give some feedback on the show, if you simply want to tell them what's on your mind, are you nervous about a procedure you're supposed to have in 2 or 3 weeks, let us know, okay? You can also watch us live on Facebook if you're on the go and you're going to step away from the television set. And you can also go online. You can stream us at WATC.TV. That's WATC.TV. And right now, we're going to go straight to the prayer room with Shawn Mitchell.
I'm your co-host, Shawn Evans Mitchell, and I'm in the prayer room. The lines are open. They've been open, and they're going to remain open during the duration of the broadcast. Please make sure you call in at 770-300-9828. I'm standing here with the most awesome, beautiful prayer leader tonight, and she's going to start it off with a wonderful scripture.
Good evening. My name is Alana from New Mercies Christian Church. Listen to the words from Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 10. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you would like to receive salvation on tonight, pray this prayer with me. Father, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. Jesus, come into my heart and be my personal Lord and Savior. I believe that Jesus died for me and God has raised him from the dead. Lord, I promise to follow you and obey you all the days of my life. If you've prayed this prayer and would like to receive salvation, give us a call. We would love to pray with you. Again, the number is 770-300-9828.
You've heard a number of the conversations out on the couch. There are a number of issues. There are a number of trials and tribulations, quite frankly, and our prayer warriors are here standing by to take your call. Do not be afraid. Do not be hesitant. Please call in 770-300-9828. Now back to the studio.
Welcome back, everyone, and just a reminder that our prayer lines are open, okay? We want to hear from you, and that is very important to us. Well, right now, I'm so excited to welcome a young lady to Atlanta Live. It's her world debut, and she is a woman at her own heart because she believes that Christ has a message for you in every situation. We have to stay steadfast and be patient to hear that. I'm talking about the one and only Dr. Jacqueline Johnson with Trinity United Methodist Church out of Stockbridge, Georgia. Welcome to Atlanta Live.
It's good to be here.
Very excited to have you, okay? Yeah. Now, there's a lot going on right now in the world. I know there's a lot of things that you are passionate about. But right now, tonight, one of the things you want to lead off with is talking about our children,
yes,
the safety of our youth in our communities, and a word that makes a lot of people uncomfortable, but it's a harsh reality here in the Atlanta metropolitan area, talking about human trafficking, Dr. Johnson.
Yes.
Tell us what it looks like in 2018, because I think so many of us have an idea of what it tends to look like from some of the movies from the 80s and 90s. And some people don't think necessarily that it's a problem here locally. That's a third world problem. Explain.
Yes, and that is very sad. Okay. The truth is it's more prevalent than we realize in our communities. And you hear often on the news, people say, well, this is a very nice community.
Okay.
It is in our very communities that our children as young as 12, girls and boys, are being victimized and forced into human trafficking, sex trafficking, which is modern-day slavery.
Oh, wow. And I want to make this clear. These children, these young people are victims.
Yes.
Regardless, right, of what people, the choice they may think they're making, they're not mature enough and wise enough and informed enough to know that decision. They're victims, okay?
Yes, yes.
Explain to someone watching us right now at home. They're thinking, well, if the parents are involved in these kids' lives, how can this happen, Dr. Johnson? Explain.
Well, children are very trusting.
Yes, they are.
And we, even in the schools, they learn at a very early age stranger danger.
Okay, yes, we do.
But they're still very trusting. Mm-hmm. And with human sex trafficking today, you have teens and younger people and women who will actually befriend the children.
Oh, my.
Another teen befriending a teen.
Okay.
And then they're tricked into life that is so horrific.
Wow. I mean, and I'm imagining these people are serving as middle people, right?
Yes.
So here you have perhaps a young woman that's 20 years old befriending a 17-year-old girl, something that didn't necessarily look inappropriate, right? Mm-hmm. But then she's connecting her to perhaps young men or older men,
yes,
who are then manipulating her or his mind, because mm-hmm. you said boys and girls both mm-hmm. can be victims of it, and then doing horrifying acts and taking innocence from these children.
Absolutely. And believe it or not, Shana, it is also teens who are also living a life of slaves. Oh. They're afraid. They're being treated in such a way that they believe that their family members will be harmed if they don't do what they are being forced to do.
I see.
And so it's not a 20-year-old that will befriend a teenager, it's a teenager befriending a teenager.
I see.
And it's girls. And so you're more trusting, or our children are more trusting to trust their peers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And so they're easily tricked.
And you're right. And they're thinking, this is my friend, right? Mm-hmm. Mom and dad, mm-hmm. you may not think that, but they're my friends. And
yes.
they're listening to me. And you're right. We've all been young teenagers where you tend to identify more with someone mm-hmm. your age, your peers, even though they're not saying information that's best for you. We've all been there, I think, where you're like, well, they're my friend. They're going to be honest with mm-hmm. me.
Or they're my boyfriend.
Yes.
You know, young girls fall in love with teenage boys and
Absolutely.
He's my boyfriend. Or an older gentleman who's buying them, spending money on them and buying them whatever their hearts desire. He loves me. This is my boyfriend. This is my girlfriend. This is my big sister that I never had.
I see. Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? And they're truly easily tricked.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my.
You may have touched on this earlier, but how does it start when you have that person that the victim is familiar with? In other words, if it's the boyfriend, what would prompt the boyfriend to become involved in such an act that he's willing to hurt his...
Well, it's a ruse, you see.
Mm-hmm.
He's being forced mm-hmm. to do what he's doing. And sometimes it's the money.
Okay.
It is the money that is enticing. They get paid so much for every young person that they bring in.
Oh, my.
And so they're trusting. And then our young people are so starved for love. They're looking for love.
That's true.
And they absolutely believe that this person loves them. And if you love me, then I have a friend, you know.
Wow.
What you do with me, I want you to do with my friend.
And you know, Dr. Johnson, let's dig a little deeper. Some individuals, young, middle-aged, or older, mm-hmm. may associate love with attention. Those two are very different.
Mm.
But I think when we're talking about children, and we've all been young once, and when we all, everyone on here is mothers as well, and you know, your grandmother as well,
yes,
congratulations.
Yes, thank you.
But we know children tend to like attention. And so here you're right. I think they see this young man is interested in me. He's giving me attention.
Mm-hmm.
And hey, I'm young. I don't really know what love is necessarily, but attention must be love. Right.
Absolutely.
And so
in
their mind, they've been misguided and misled about what love and caring and trust really is about.
It's very similar to gang initiation also.
I see. Mm-hmm.
Whatever we are not getting at home, we really are loving our kids, but they're getting more attention. I was I've been a working mother and my children wanted to spend more time with me.
Yes.
But I'm gone, and so they tend to turn to where they get the attention.
Okay. Even if it's in the wrong places.
Yes.
And that's devastating. You know, let's talk about something that I'm sure so many guardians watching right now want to know more about. Anybody can be a victim to this.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, share with us important notes or checklists of things that could help us help prevent our kids from being victims. We know sometimes you can mm-hmm. do everything right and still be a victim. What are some useful tips, Dr. Johnson?
Well, what a lot of parents don't seem to understand is huge events like major conferences,
okay.
The NFL, you know, Super Bowl games that bring in large crowds.
Okay.
Atlanta, Hartsville, you know, the airport is the busiest airport in the nation.
It is.
And so, in the world, actually. And we have people that fly in. They take orders for young people.
Oh, wow.
And I would recommend, or I would suggest strongly to parents, gone are the days that we can let the malls babysit our kids.
Okay.
Or drop our kids off at venues like that.
I see. Just
we need to
them.
Be
okay.
with them, or we need to school them and educate them on the signs to look for. And they already know, who am I talking about? I'm talking about those who are out there searching for potential victims know exactly what to look for.
My.
Those kids who are by themselves or young girls without parents around.
Okay.
They're looking for them.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So they're looking for vulnerability mm-hmm. in so many words as
yes.
well. And you brought up a valid point. I mean, most Americans are working parents. They have to work or choosing to work. And I think there's always that balance of guilt that working parents have, right?
Yes.
But you're saying we need to be a balance. Although we have to work, we have to provide as well. Mm-hmm. But I would imagine we still need to know where our children are, especially our young children. And
yes.
we're not talking about 25-year-olds,
yes.
right? We're talking about 15, 14-year-olds. You know, that interesting state where they're saying, well, I'm grown enough to mm-hmm. be by myself, and I can go to the movies by myself, Mom. You know, get off my back. These mm-hmm. are things that every parent mm-hmm. I've certainly heard them say. What would you suggest to that mom or dad right now watching us at home or on the go on Facebook Live? And they're saying, I try to get in their life. I'm trying to say, who are you mm-hmm. hanging with? But they're pushing me away, and they're thinking, I don't want to be that mom that's too overwhelming. I don't want to be that helicopter mom. Mm-hmm. How do I reach that balance?
I think that we have to be intentional about checking, tracking them and checking okay. their social media.
Yes.
You know, looking at their phones and then again, having those conversations.
Okay.
Talking to your children. Mm-hmm.
Even when it makes us uncomfortable, because you know that's one of those conversations where parents are like, well, I'd rather not. Mm-hmm. Maybe I can show them a YouTube video. But you would say it's important as well to be intimate and express our concerns to our children.
Absolutely.
And not leave that up to television.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And then know the signs.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
There's a reason if all of a sudden your child is withdrawn or your child is pulling away those conversations with them. And sometimes when they are... I find this boyfriend, or I have this girl who's interested in me. You know, Mom, I don't want to talk about that. It's time to ask questions.
Okay.
Talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Get in their
okay.
business.
That's mm-hmm. right.
And I think it's time for us to get back to the village, you know, the village to raise a child.
Because village to raise a child.
As you mentioned, and we're all working parents, many of us, mm-hmm. we have to rely on others that we trust, mm-hmm. and we have to make sure that we're looking out for all of the neighborhood or community children. So with regard to your particular platform and initiative, mm-hmm. is there a focus on that as well?
Yes.
Oh, great.
More community conversations that
great.
We're having.
Okay.
I work at the Cochrane Public Library also. I'm the branch manager there. We have community conversations. We partner with the Henry County School System. And we bring experts in, people who are actually out there on the streets, you know, trying to rescue these children who are trapped in the programs. And they are the ones who can speak directly to the parents and to help educate on the things that they need to, you know the signs. And so we have those communications, we have those conversations pretty regularly in the school system, but in the library. And we have a forum to where you can ask the questions that maybe aren't being asked today.
Mm, wow, which is powerful.
Excellent.
You know, I have to ask this. She brought up the village, Shawn, you did, and you were saying we have to, at some point, everyone knows, and trust your kids with someone mm-hmm. else to take care of them. I once was a part of a human trafficking forum where they brought the word trust up and mm-hmm. saying children are trusting, and sometimes working parents, and that's most of America,
yes.
that we want to be trusting of individuals when it comes to our children and the care of our children, right? Especially when they're young. You
yes.
need extra supervision. Mm-hmm. But the speaker, who was an expert, said you have to be very careful about who you're having your kids around. And obviously there are individuals that can mm-hmm. dub us and manipulate, and you don't know, right? Anyone
correct,
can always
correct.
Be a victim of any circumstance. I do want to emphasize that again. But this individual, who was also a social worker, said you need to vet the individuals that are babysitting
yes.
or supervising
yes.
your child.
Mm-hmm.
Because she said it's easy to say, well, someone wants to help me. They're grinding their way to help me and bring my kid home from practice. But she said you have to sometimes question that motive. And
absolutely.
At the end of the day, mm-hmm. you're the parent, you're the guardian. And if you don't trust it, she said, never doubt your gut. And I thought that was interesting mm-hmm. because so many times I think we have to feel we have to verbalize, we have to make logic out of why we don't want this. But she was saying it's your kids and
yes.
you want them to
yes.
be safe.
Yes.
And she's saying you have to be careful even who's in your village or you think you can trust.
Absolutely.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And we have to avoid, get away from being too trusting that we do allow our children to run free. I see it all the time in the mall, in the food court, for example,
yes,
where there are young children running to the restrooms by themselves. I think oftentimes when individuals, adults are too trusting, that's when the door opens for that type of potential violation.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We have my grandchildren getting up in age now. I just had a granddaughter to graduate from high school.
Oh, congratulations!
Yeah. My granddaughters love to be dropped off at the mall.
Okay.
You know, they have that free time away from mom, and they're with their friends, and so they have a little money in their pocket, and they want to go shopping. And I'm that grandparent that's, okay, you're letting her go to the mall?
Okay.
What day is that? That's the day I need to do some shopping myself.
I see.
They don't know I'm
Look,
there, but
grandmother's
I'm there.
Here. What a coincidence.
I give them their space,
You
know, but it does take a village, and we need to get more engaged and more involved.
Absolutely. It's powerful. Now, talking about village and involvement, of course, you're a pastor of a church. You're coming up on your retirement. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Trinity United Methodist Church, which is based in Stockbridge, Georgia.
Stockbridge, one of the best churches in Stockbridge.
Yeah,
Trinity
United Methodist Church. And a powerful beacon in the community at large.
Congratulations.
I would like to say that as well. When it comes to church, of course, there's a family that's in church. Right now, there may be someone listening to us. Maybe they're 33, 34 years old, and they're saying, you know what? I have a relationship with God, but I'm really not seeing the use of being in a church family. Dr. Johnson, what would you say to that viewer right now?
I would say to them, you know, the Bible tells us to, you know, gather together and worship.
Okay.
And you don't have to worship in a church. But it's so much better when you're with a group of believers.
That's right. Powerful.
To just powerful
Beautiful.
When you're with a group of believers who can just celebrate the Lord together, to worship God together. And my way of thinking and my faith was broadened more when I got connected and involved in a church family.
Mm. That's important. Mm-hmm. And I also would say for all the guardians and parents out there as well, you know, churches can be so powerful in helping with the upbringing of our children, right? I mean, one, you're getting the education of the Bible, God's Word. And when we talk about education, and we're both proponents for it, and you, of course, as well, and being a huge supporter of literacy as a librarian, but we need to also talk about the education of our faith, of our God and His Word.
Yes.
And I think that's something that sometimes we overlook because we're saying academics. But I do believe wholeheartedly that you're more well-grounded and you're more well-rounded when you're educated in your Word of God as well as lay books.
Absolutely.
Right?
It's very important to know the Word and to have the Word inside of you.
Correct.
But to study the Word, I study all the time. You can study at home. But when you ask those questions and you get with a group of people and studying the Word of God, you realize that someone else's answer is the answer that you've been looking for. And outside of the church, you may not go to church, but you can look for God in everyday life.
Yes.
And if you look for God, you'll find God.
He is there.
He's there. Yeah.
And I just love the church family because I think that's powerful. And there's so many options for people out there as well. If someone possibly has been hurt by a church family, I know you would recommend as a pastor that don't give up on God because of that, right? Because people are people and God is God.
Don't give up on God. Know that God loves you. And, you know, God is always present with us. We may not realize it. And I once had someone who had recently been raped. And she said, where was God when I was being raped? And I, trying to really feel the way she was feeling, I couldn't do that, but I could empathize. And I could say to her, He was present with you, even in the midst of everything that you went through
but my
and
God.
Brought you through.
Oh, my God. Dr. Johnson, have to have you back on. What a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you
for joining us on Atlanta Live. We're going to be back. We've got 30 more minutes. Stay with us. Dr. Johnson, thank you again. Out of Stockbridge, Georgia.
Welcome back to Atlanta Live. I'm Shawn Evans-Mitchell and the one and only
Shana Thornton, radio talk show host and online blogger.
That's right. Shana, that was an awesome first half. We had, inspirational and empowering. Now we're going to just take it all in, recap, and wait for some wonderful music.
Shawn. And as you said, there's a lot that we tuck in the first hour.
Yeah.
But stay with us for this final 30 minutes of Atlanta Live, featured right here on WATC TV channel 57, because we have more for you. Our upcoming guest believes in the power of education and awareness. And he's going to talk about something near and dear to his heart. He's talking about veterans and the disabled Americans out there. He says that's a population that's often is not spotlighted, and he wants something to be done about it.
Absolutely. And we're not going to tag it right now because he has a lot to share, but there's something very special and unique about this young man that he will provide for the audience.
Yes, and he has a new book out where he thinks that any of us can be leaders in our very own way. I love that. He's talking about being a trailblazer within yourself. You have to stay with us. But just a friendly reminder that the prayer lines are open, and you're going to find that telephone number right there at the bottom of your screen. Please call that right now. We're live on the air. We would love to hear from you. Again, there's nothing too minute or nothing too gigantic that God cannot work with you with. And we're here with his vessels. We have prayer warriors with us now. Now, we're going to go live to the music set. And right now, we're talking about Micah Stampley. And the name of this song is The Son of God.
Hallelujah. Today, oh God. The Son of God is lifted high.
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 Yes, Lord. The Son of God is lifted high. Put your hands together, everybody. Let's say it again, right where you are. The Son of God is lifted high.
Jesus, the Son of God is
high, God. High above the earth. There's nobody like you, Jesus. Oh, Son of God. Savior, wonderful counselor, mighty God. Oh, Son of God, be with me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
That's right, Miss Shana. He deserves all of our praise. What
beautiful,
a beautiful,
beautiful.
And speaking of beautiful, we have yet another beautiful testimony sitting before us.
Yes.
Decorated retired veteran, Dr. Cedrick Spears in our midst.
Welcome, certainly into
live. Thank you.
We're excited to have you. Now, about this at the top of the second hour, that you spotlight groups of individuals that sometimes you believe are overlooked. And we're talking about veterans, disabled
yes.
individuals.
Yes.
Tell us what motivated this platform for you.
Well, I'm a veteran.
Okay.
So a disabled veteran. I know I don't look like it.
Okay.
But I'm a disabled veteran, so that's a passion. I have a passion and love for helping elderly and
powerful.
Disabled, and especially veterans. Hence that two of my locations for home care are in military towns.
I see.
Clarksville, Tennessee,
okay.
which is a military town, and then Killeen, Texas, which is a military
wow.
town. So I always wanted three locations, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Mm.
So Atlanta is one in Buckhead here, and Clarksville, Tennessee, and Killeen, Texas, military towns.
Wow.
Yeah, near to my heart.
And when we talk about putting the spotlight on disabled veterans,
mm-hmm.
what exactly do you want to talk about? Because I know you
yes.
believe that awareness and education
mm-hmm.
of services
yes.
is critical.
Yes.
Why?
I tell you, it's so critical. My father, disabled veteran.
Okay.
But I want to spotlight it because people don't know that they can receive in-home care and little to no cost to them. There are programs out there that through the VA,
okay.
Department of Veteran Affairs, that veterans and their surviving spouses can receive in-home care. I'm talking about 10 hours a week of someone coming in and providing services such as bathing, hygiene, meal preparation, light housekeeping, errand, transportation.
Okay.
And what this service does, when you bring that awareness, because I didn't know that this was, I was entitled to this.
I see.
And that's my job, is to put that word out so people know that you can get this service in-home where you much rather be. We want to keep you out of the nursing homes, at home where you feel much more comfortable. You know, you don't deteriorate as quickly when you're at home because you feel safe, secure.
Zone.
Yes, yes. So we want to keep it at home where they much rather be, providing services through quality personal care.
And Dr. Spears, you bring up a point, and not just we're talking about disabled veterans,
mm-hmm.
but I want to say just medical community or any arena,
mm-hmm.
that sometimes I think we have expectations that, well, the information would just come to me, and
mm-hmm.
I would have heard about it, right, from television
right.
or one of the many magazines I like reading.
Mm-hmm.
But you're a huge advocate yeah. of getting information and seeking it.
Mm-hmm.
How important is that in 2018? Because you know someone could say, Shawn, we are bombarded with information coming from everywhere, but I think
yeah.
we all know there's real news and there's fake news.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to really decipher through what is useful information. How do you
yeah.
balance that?
I'll tell you, we perish for a lack of knowledge.
Okay.
We have to get the knowledge. One of my mottos is, when in doubt, call and find out.
Yeah.
You know? And then execution.
Mm-hmm.
Execution. We send a message out, and then we say, well, we send it, but you have to follow up. You have to dig for it, because some things that's worth having, you got to do a little bit of work to
I
get
see.
It. So this is an awesome service that can get a person in your home and alleviate so much stress and
okay.
pain in the family, deciding whether I should retire to take care of mom, dad, or loved one. But yeah, no, don't do that. You have a service
okay.
that can come in and just make everything okay. But seeking that information, that's why I have to do everything in my power to make sure it gets out. So anytime I get a platform, speaking here, there, yes, and everywhere, I want to raise that awareness.
Wow. I mean, yeah, that's powerful. Yeah. When you talked about people saying, well, sometimes I have to retire or resign. A lot of people are not at a point where they can retire at a job, right? Where they say, I've got to help my parents or my grandmother or grandfather. But when you said that, to me, it brought up caretakers and the balance of being a caretaker.
Yes.
Because being a caretaker is not easy, right? I've known some, very close friends with some, and they're saying it can be challenging. It can be emotionally wrecking on individuals and the family unit they're in. But what you are doing, which I love, you're offering another alternative for these individuals to say, here, mom or dad can still be in their home. Because a lot of individuals, Americans, I think, necessarily don't want to leave their home, if it's possible, because I'm sure there's some situations where they have to, and that's an individual basis. But you're saying they can get assistance and help where perhaps maybe it can allow that person to still perhaps be productive and help care for mom or dad?
Yes. Quality of life. And I tell you, there are caregiver support groups because it takes a special kind of person to take care of elderly and disabled. So there are so many support groups that the state offers to help support those caregivers when they have to see certain individuals in certain states.
Yes.
And that can weigh heavy on the mind. And then the grieving process once they're taking care of someone for months, days, years, and then they're gone. So how do you cope with that? How do you deal with that? But there are through quality personal care as well and state, and hey, they'll support you through and teach you that grieving process and how to kind of process those type things. Yes, yes, yes.
The help is there. I know we're going to talk about it a little more, but give us the website. I'm sure it's at the bottom of the screen right now. But where our viewers can go for more information about the services you spoke of.
Okay, perfect. That's www.q, as in queen, P as in papa, care. So it's short for quality personal care. So qpcare.com, and you'll see all three of our locations. You'll see our office.
Yes.
Wonderful services that we offer. I tell you, I'm excited about my babies.
And because of that excitement, we know that everyone involved is getting the quality care they need. Tell us again how you were inspired. When the initial thought came to mind, how did you take that and run with it?
Well, I was in the military, as we stated previously, just wasn't fulfilled. It was a good stepping stone, but if I felt something within, I should take care of my grandmother.
I see.
When I was in middle school, high school, I would go back and forth to Tennessee, to North Carolina, where she resided.
Okay.
And I would take care of her. She was elderly and disabled. And I said, man, it's rewarding within itself. And they said, what are you going to do when you get out in the military, when you get out? I said, first, I'm going to keep trusting God, but I'm going to pursue this passion and this love that I feel within. I have to do something about this. So I did my due diligence and searching and demographic checks. And what can I do to help elderly and disabled? And I stumbled across home care for elderly. And at that time, I didn't have a degree, no experience or anything, but I had God, you know. So I just took what was within and caused it to inspire home care and that passion and love that I knew that was within me. So, that's what it was. I tell you, love for helping elderly and disabled.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you shared something with us about your age, something that was very unique as to...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm 20. No, I'm lying on that stuff. But I'm 37 now, but I started 14 years ago. Oh, 24.
Okay.
But yes, we did some research and people, I said, no, what, maybe not. But the youngest man to start a home care agency in the United States.
Wow.
I would say the world, but I know the United States. But not just mom and pop, but actually licensed with the state, actually contracts with VA and Medicaid and state funding programs. And I tell you, it just got no franchise, no partnership, no this, that. But I had something within that really helped me expand
Amazing.
To three different locations now.
You had the drive that God gave you to do, and those gifts are very prevalent always. You know, let's talk about your book. Let's transition some, because I know you have a new book out, and it's titled Leadership Qualities, Exploring the Effectiveness in Ministry and Marketplace. Now, that's a mouthful, Dr. Spears.
Yeah.
Leadership qualities, I'm used to that. Ministry and marketplace.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's something we're not used to necessarily seeing together. Explain why.
Well, a lot of people try to separate it.
Okay.
But because the traditional mindset would say, some people ask, hey, do you have a ministry? And they automatically think about a church. And I said, well, at that time, no. But someone had to enlighten me. They said, man, do you know quality personal care is your ministry?
Wow.
You're helping elderly, you're feeding them, clothing them,
yes.
coming to their home, assisting, meeting them right where they are. So is it not your ministry? And I said, Lord, I've been preaching and pastoring for 14 years and didn't know.
That's
so,
right.
But I'm so glad, yes, that's the ministry part of it. And the book, Quality Personal Care, inspired a lot of things. It inspired this book. It inspired starting a book publishing company. Wow. Just all kind of stuff.
Dr. Spears,
to speaking all over the United States, the world, this, that, and the other. Quality Personal Care birthed that. And God birthed Quality Personal Care. So I give him all the credit and the glory.
Always.
But the book is just different leadership styles, what styles are effective, what styles are less effective. You know, you have the laissez-faire style of leadership.
Okay.
They're so lazy, they don't want to do, and that productivity is low. But then you have the authoritarian style that they do this, do that. That used to work, but people, you tell them now, they're going to leave. You know, but I love the mentoring.
I see.
Leadership style, which Jesus was the great example of, a mentor leader.
Yes, he was.
He mentored 12 guys for 3 years and made them so great that we're talking about them today.
Mm-hmm.
So I love a mentor leadership style and also a servant leader. I'm a servant leader, mentor leader, servant leader. I lead, I serve first, lead second.
Wow. But in so many ways, you're leading by example.
Yes.
Because I think one of the most effective ways, I think, to be a leader, mm-hmm. and that's being a father or a mother in your home,
yes.
is for people want to see sincerity,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes.
Because most people, especially our children, yeah. can spot what's real and what's fake,
that's
if you
true.
Will.
That's
and
true.
Then sincerity, but then there's a passion for it,
yes.
and that you're consistent. Now, yes. we're all human. We all have
yes.
hiccups along the way,
yes.
but
yes.
that we're consistent. And mm-hmm. I think when you have consistency, you have respect
yes.
for that person. And there's so much that can be taught through respect. When you talk about leadership.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so true. And we have to lead by example, because if your subordinates or followers don't respect you, you're not going to get very
Correct.
Far. And if you want to know if you're a leader, look around. Is
okay.
anyone following you?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's, hey,
yeah.
is anyone following you?
And in flipping through this book, I love the voice. I love the conversation you use. And I just don't know how this happened, but I just happened to stumble on chapter 5.
Oh, yeah.
Women in leadership. So let's talk about that, women in leadership a little bit.
Hey, I admire women leaders because, you know, they could be frowned upon. Do women really supposed to lead? How effective?
Okay.
Let me tell you something. Especially when it comes to the church, you take the women out, you have nothing.
Wow.
You know, so I respect women leaders. I have pastor women, women pastors.
Okay.
And I learned so much from them. And they instill so much within me. So I had to pay homage, so to speak, to that. When people want to look over, you better get it together. Wake up, smell the coffee.
You know, when you said that, Dr. Spears, it reminds me of the fact that we can learn from anyone, right?
That's right.
So sometimes I think we're saying, well, I need to learn from someone who has a degree if I don't have a degree,
mm.
or someone
mm.
that perhaps lives in a bigger apartment than mine. But you believe, you shared with us earlier mm. in prepping, that anybody can inspire us because God can be present in places we don't expect.
That's
mm-hmm.
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and in the Bible, they didn't expect them to speak through a bush.
Mm. Wow.
So I know, in fact, just on that women part, hey, if he can entrust a woman to carry the living word,
yes.
why can't they carry the written word?
Wow.
So I'm going to listen to women because they, I tell you, he would just had her appear, you know,
mm-hmm.
Jesus appear,
yes.
but he had trusted women so much. But I tell you, that's very important to me.
Yes.
So that's very important to me, is women and leadership. I have to stay on that one for a second. I'm not trying to just suck up.
Dr. Spears, where do you yes. see yourself in 5 years? Because you've had a very successful platform. You're continuing to gain mm. traction, gain attention mm. for all the right reasons. Where do you see yourself in 5 years?
How do you ask these wonderful questions? And y'all are beautiful, by the way. Man, 5 years, I was just talking to some consultants about that.
Okay.
And we were planning out some things. Now, I take care of elderly and disabled in their homes. Now, I'm a big boy now, so I have to bring them too. So I'm looking at purchasing, what is it called? Assisted living facilities.
Okay.
So I'm purchasing I'm putting it all out. Purchasing it very soon. So now, instead of us going to them, they come to us. But it's growing your portfolio because now you own property. So I'm graduated. I'm a baby, but I'm getting there. You know?
I love it. but growing up well.
Yeah, 5 years. That's why we started the book publishing company. I love to write now. I never thought I would love to write, especially growing up with disability, and they said I wasn't college material and this and that and the other. But I'm writing books, so I started. Definitely want to do that.
Yes.
And it's a new book that I just finished called Blessed, Bold, and Brilliant Quotes for Your Soul. It's about 10 years worth of quotes. You know how Facebook reminds
yes,
you?
Yes, yes, of what you did.
And I said, you know what? The Holy Spirit said, bless the world with these quotes.
Wow.
And it's a 90-day devotional. It's your scripture, your quote, a prayer over every page, and a journal where the Holy Spirit speaks to you. 5 years, I want to just speak all over the world about how you can be successful in ministry and marketplace.
Wow, and you are the epitome of that. You've done that very well. You have a very bright future ahead of you. As we wrap up, we have a few seconds left. Remind our viewers at home, the ones watching us on Facebook on the go, where they can go for more information about your organization.
That's QPCare.com, short for Quality Personal Care, and they also can come to drdrcedricspears.com for the books, the speaking engagements, this, that, and the other. And lastly, just to be real quick, there was a family in Clarksville, Tennessee. I don't want to put out the names. The husband survived, and one of the sons, but the mother and the daughter burned in the fire in their home. Now their home is the model. If you go to drcedricspears.com and purchase any one of those books, Leadership Quality or the Blessed, Bold, and Brilliant Quotes, I want to donate to that family and make sure they get their house recovered. And your mother is gone. Your wife is gone. We have to help and step up. So I want to do, if they go and on social media, just the handle is Dr. Cedrick Spears. And the website as well, drcedricspears.com. Purchase that book and let's bless this family.
And thank you for all that you're doing with that platform and supporting that family. And I'm sure if people have more questions about that family to reach out to you as well. What an amazing conversation, Dr. Spears. Thank you for joining us here on Atlanta Live. Continue all of your success. Keep it going.
Thank you.
There's a lot in store, and certainly connect with that young man. And the sky is the limit. And as he reminded us, you can find the quality of God, the love of God, wherever you go. And his travels have certainly done that as well. Well, everyone, we're done with our talk show set, but we're going to go to the music set now. And we're going to hear another beautiful musical selection from Micah Stampley. And the name of this song is saying Hallelujah.
All creation, every knee shall bow, every tongue must confess that he is Lord. So we join together every culture, every nationality. From the earth, we proclaim your majesty. Behold the King, the Lamb of royal deity. There is none like you who is faithful and true. In your word, we find grace, peace, and strength. Yes, Lord.
majesty.